Hi, this is Manos Berlakis, and this is video 19.4 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video discusses how to approach complications of rotational atherectomy that also applies to a large extent to complications of orbital atherectomy. Both rotational and orbital atherectomy are forms of lesion preparation, which in turn is step number 9 of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention. These are the 5 complications that will be discussed in this video. First, decreased undergrade flow. Second, perforation. Third, bare entrapment. 4, arrhythmias. And 5, fracture of the atherectomy wire. And starting with the first one, decreased undergrade flow, the 2 main mechanisms are dissection or embolization, although spasm can play a role as well. The most common causes are atherectomy of small and tortuous vessels using large burrs and high speed with both rotational and orbital atherectomy, but also risk factors for having slow flow and distal embolization are performing long runs because there is more debris liberated and having a short interval between the runs. Ideally, one should spend enough time waiting between the runs to allow for any debris to go through the microcirculation before additional debris is released during atherectomy. Also, if there is dampened pressure waveform on the guide, there can be reduced undergrade flow that can predispose to plugging of the microvasculature, and also not giving prophylactically vasodilators. In our lab, we routinely give 100 to 200 mics of nicardipine, which has a long duration of action, as well as less hypotensive effect than other vasodilators. What to do? If dissection is the problem, then stenting is the answer. If embolization is the problem, then giving vasodilators usually provides relief, and those can be nicardipine, nitroprusside, verapamil, as well as adenosine. And ideally, those should be given through microcatheter to allow delivery in the vessel that has the nori flow and the distal embolization. This is an example of dissection after atherectomy of a heavily calcified LAD. There is a hazy filling defect into the LAD. There is also ST segment elevation on the EKG. This is another example, a patient who had atherectomy of a calcified right coronary artery. There is a dissection in the distal right coronary artery that resolved after placing stents. The second potential complication is perforation, and actually atherectomy is one of the most quoted reasons for developing perforation. What can predispose to having a perforation is performing atherectomy in small and tortuous vessels, similar to dissection, having a large burr and using high speed. Also, another potential cause is doing atherectomy close to the tip of the guide wire. For both the rotablation wire as well as the orbital atherectomy wires, the tip is actually thicker than the more proximal segment. And if the burr or the crown get too close to the tip, they can lead to fracture of the tip and potential exit of the burr or the crown and causing a massive perforation. Also, in very tortuous lesions, if there is strong wire bias, that can lead to more effect on a specific segment of the vessel that can predispose to perforation. What to do if a perforation happens? This is discussed separately on the video, but the main step and the first step to do is to inflate a balloon to occlude the perforated vessel. And then these are most commonly large vessel perforations, which usually require placement of a covered stent for sealing. Balloon alone is unlikely to lead to sealing, but cover stent is commonly needed. Moving on to the third complication, which is burr entrapment. Potential causes include forceful advancement, as well as using the 1.25 millimeter burr, performing atherectomy through prior stents and through tortuous coronary segments. The atherectomy, the rotational atherectomy, should be done in a pecking motion, touching the lesion and coming back, and not leaning in the lesion for prolonged periods of time. To prevent it, the advancement should be gentle, again in a pecking motion. The 1.5 millimeter burrs or larger are preferred, and we'll show you why in the next slide. And also, for rotational atherectomy, the burr should not be stopped distal or within the lesion. Instead, the burr should go through the lesion and coming back before stopping, because the burr only has diamond in the front end. And this is why doing atherectomy with a 1.5 millimeter burr is preferable, because the 1.25 millimeter burr is more like a bullet and the 1.5 is more like a cone. And since there is no diamond on the back end of this burr, atherectomy can only happen when going forward. So if this goes through the lesion but then cannot ablate coming backwards, entrapment can occur. What to do if there is entrapment of the rotablator burr? Sometimes the dynaglide can be used to get the burr started again to rotate and then leading to retrieval. If this doesn't work, sometimes a second guide wire can be advanced next to the entrapped burr and balloon angioplasty can be performed in an attempt to release the burr. If this doesn't work, then the shaft of the rotablation burr is cut and then the plastic sleeve removed and a guide extension advanced as far distally as possible. If this doesn't work, a snare can be added. If this doesn't work, the rota wire and the orbital wire as well, the viper wire, can be pulled back, and because the distal segment is thicker than the proximal segment, they can often pull the entrapped burr or crown back. But once again, this may fail and the guide wire may disentangle. And finally, if everything fails, then emergency cardiac surgery may be needed. This is how the rotablator burr is cut, ideally close to the device, the advancer device. And then after this is cut, then the plastic sleeve that goes over the catheter shaft is removed. And then a guide extension is advanced over the fragment of the rotablator burr all the way down to the lesion, which often suffices to pull back the entrapped burr. This is how it looks after pulling it back. Essentially, what the guide extension does is it dissects the tissue in a way, releasing the burr from attachment to the surrounding tissue. Both the rota wire as well as the viper wire are thicker distally, and that property can be used to pull the entrapped burr back, but again, don't pull very hard because that can lead to the wire being damaged. Complication number four is arrhythmias. Atherectomy can cause bradycardia, especially in the right coronary artery. This typically resolves by itself, or sometimes atropy may be given. And either aminophylline or temporary pacemaker are often used in order to prevent this bradycardia. Alternatively, tachycardias can also occur, but these typically are due to ischemia, usually in the setting of noriflow or dissection, or if there is perforation and significant pericardial effusion. Finally, the rota wire or the orbital wire can fracture. Factors predisposing to fracture is performing atherectomy, as we discussed before, close to the tip of the wire. Atherectomy over a kinked guide wire, and that is why if the wire kinks, it should be removed and replaced with a new wire. Performing atherectomy in tortuous angulated lesions and having prolonged lesion contact, and we'll show a video that illustrates that. If this happens, and there is fracture, if perforation happens, which is common, then a cover stent is needed or potentially surgery. These are massive perforations requiring immediate treatment. And then if this is not the case, then the wire fragment can sometimes be retrieved or a stent can be placed over that wire. This is a published case of rotational atherectomy that resulted in perforation. In the initial part, this is how rotational atherectomy should not be done, not having prolonged contact of the burr with the lesion. Eventually, in this case, it did yield. But ideally, what one wants to do is to have a pecking motion, a back and forth motion, similar to the second part of this video, back and forth motion with light and limited duration contact of the burr with the lesion. This is the same patient in a further down spot. There is resistance to advancing the burr, and there is very prolonged attempts for rotablation, and eventually what this led to is this dramatic perforation. The burr essentially cuts the wire and goes out of the vessel. As expected, this led to a dramatic perforation. The patient here is asystolic with this massive coronary perforation given the exit of the rotablator burr from the coronary vessel. So the lesson is, when performing rotational atherectomy, never lean on the bird. Instead, do a pecking motion back and forth rapidly, minimizing the duration of time during which the bird is touching the lesion. And if there is any kink in the guide wire, that should be removed and replaced with a new wire before proceeding. So to summarize, atherectomy does have potential complications, including decreased undergrade flow, perforation, entrapment of the bur or crown, arrhythmias, and fracture of the atherectomy wire. And the way to prevent those is to use a very meticulous technique, using large guide cutters providing good support, doing rapid pecking motion with limited contact time with the lesion with rotational atherectomy versus slow advancement with orbital atherectomy, using relatively slow speeds for both modalities, and then not using kinked guide wires. Paying attention to all the basic details can minimize the risk of any resulting complications. Thank you.